Well, good evening and welcome once again to the Eisenhower Presidential Library Museum and Boyhood Home. I'm Tim Reeves, the Deputy Director. In 2013, we began a series of exhibits and programs under the overall title World War II Leaders, Battles, and Heroes. And just 3 years ago, we held, or 3 years ago, 3 days ago, almost felt like 3 years, our D-Day commemorative events, which drew more than 25,000 visitors over those 3 days to our campus. We heard the stories of Omaha Beach veterans among many other memorable programs, including that of our keynote speaker, Mr. Nigel Hamilton, who's here with us tonight. Nigel is also our guest historian for our World War II Teachers Workshop, which is in progress. So I'd like to recognize all of our teachers here tonight. If you'd like to wave or somehow make yourself known to the rest of us, thank you. And they're all working with our educational specialist, Kim Barbieri. Well, today I'm almost a little embarrassed to add it's another 70th anniversary of the war, not one that we're really commemorating, but just one that I thought was kind of interesting that I would point to tonight. And today, June 10th, is actually the 70th anniversary of the first full-length biography ever published of Dwight Eisenhower. It hit bookshelves the same week as the D-Day invasion. And it's interesting that the book ends on the eve of the D-Day invasion, so it makes you wonder what would have happened to all these copies of the book if that had gone the other way. But 70 years ago today. But also something much more important than just this book happened 70 years ago this year, and that was the aerial invasion of Burma by the Air Commandos. And Dr. Dennis Okerstrom is here to share with us the interesting history of these early special operators who are chronicled in his new book, Project 9, The Birth of the Air Commandos in World War II, which of course you all know by now is available in our gift shop. Dennis also, as you will see, brought some very special guests with him this evening whom he will introduce. Dennis is the author of four previous books and he's a professor of English at Park University. He's also a certified flight instructor and flies his own restored 1942 scout plane. So please welcome Dennis Okerstrom.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Tim. I appreciate the kind words. I do want to start this out by asking if we have any veterans, besides the ones that I know in the front row. Are there any veterans here tonight? How about if you stand up? Thank you all. Thank you very much for all that you guys have done. Really, it's great to be here tonight. The timing, I think, of this particular program just couldn't be any better when you think about D-Day, which was last Friday, June 6th. And, you know, it's always kind of interesting to think about, you know, when you see these. I have a good friend who took the honor flight back to D.C. on June 6th. And got up at, you know, dark 30 and went to the airport and ended up in D.C. and got back about 10 o'clock that night, and he's still recovering. But, we see these guys and we think, how could they have fought a war? You know, they can barely walk, some of them. They were kids, and we often forget that. They were just kids by our standards today, and they didn't think of themselves as kids. They thought of themselves as men, but for people of my generation, and we were thinking of them, you know, being 18, 19, 20 years old. I'll leave it to you as to whether you think they were kids or not. I do really want to thank a number of people just for having this venue and allowing me to be able to talk to you tonight about the Air Commandos. Thanks to Carl Wiesenbach, okay, director, and the associate director, Tim Reeves. I also appreciate very much Samantha Kenner and Linda Smith and all the staff here. You know, a good part of this book, Project 9, originated with research done right here at this research library. I got a lot of never before published information about what was called the Quebec Conference, where President Franklin Delano Roosevelt met with Churchill and all the combined chiefs of staff, and they set up this rather colorful, rather unorthodox, and highly unusual group called Project 9, which eventually became the first Air Commandos. Let me just kind of tell you what we're going to do tonight. and that way you'll know kind of what to expect. I'm going to talk to you a little bit, show you some photos of the first Air Commandos. I'll probably bore you with reading a few selections from this book. And then I'm going to invite some special guests up, and I hope that you will not be shy. We're going to have a microphone. I'm going to kind of prime the pump at this point, and we're going to have a conversation, and I'm going to ask some questions of these three gentlemen, who you probably have guessed by now were first Air Commandos in the invasion of Burma. And then we're going to let you guys ask the questions of any of them that you want, the answers to, anything that's on your mind, just remember it's a mixed audience. Okay. I do want to recognize some people tonight, though. Some people have gone to a lot of trouble to be here. Okay. I'd like to introduce Mr. Wes Fields. He is security director for a group known as the Doolittle Raiders. Maybe you've heard of them. Wes is a former Air Commando, not from World War II, but he had a rack of ribbons about that deep. I've seen that. Mr. Keith Roberts is here from Vermont. Oh, by the way, Wes comes all the way from Fort Walton Beach, Florida, to be with you tonight. And Mr. Keith Roberts, who is the son of Maurice Ray Roberts, who was a crew chief on a C-47 that was piloted by Dick Cole. Okay, we have Cindy Cole Schall, who's up here from the Hill Country of Texas. Okay, hey, my grandson is here. Okay, that's my grandson Chase, and none of this would have been possible without my wife Jeanette, because I'm the guy, as I'm working to type these books out, and the screen goes blank, and I just scream. Any of you do that? I just scream. I just lost it. 3 months worth of writing and it's gone. Blank screen. She just, no, dear, it's like this. And there it is again. I don't know how she does it, but this magic finger kind of things, you know? I don't know. She's a wizard, waves a wand, whatever she does. She also makes a pretty good chauffeur. She drives us all over to do this and to do that, and it just couldn't be possible without her, so I appreciate all of that. Let me see how we can get this thing started. So let me just real quickly show you some photos of the first Air Commandos. I'm going to keep leaning over this so you can hear me. This is an unabashed plug for the book, okay? Project 9, published by the University of Missouri Press, okay, this year. In fact, this library bookstore got the very first copies. I didn't have a copy until I bought one in here just a few minutes ago. Okay. Now, that's the truth. That's the truth, okay. Okay, so information there if you're interested. It's the same thing. Okay. Oh, we're gonna do full screen, but I don't know how to do that. Yeah. Well, we're trying to do this. That was my grandson, who's kind of a smart aleck. But the other day, I bought a small portable tape recorder, and I was the little digital ones, and I was very carefully reading the manual. And he said, "What are you doing, Pop?" I said, "Well, I'm trying to, you know." And he said, "Let me see that." He said, "Well, you need to set the date and the time." I said, "I'm trying to figure out how to do that." He said, "Let me see it." In 2 seconds, he had it. I wanted to kill him. You know, he's of the generation that was born with those genes. They don't have to do anything. They just know it. Okay, there we go. The first Air Commando group, as I said, was a pretty colorful and unorthodox bunch of guys. This happens to be the patch for the glider section of that, and if you'll look very carefully, you may notice that this was designed by young men far away from home and from the comforts of being able to date young women. That's all I'm going to say. Okay. There were three main figures in this group, a guy named Major General Ord Wingate. That's him on the left in the funny-looking helmet. Johnny Allison is in the middle, and Phil Cochran is on the right. And more about them in a bit. Okay, Wingate was a British general who was brilliant. He was eccentric, certainly unorthodox, and you'll hear a little bit more about that in a bit. He was the leader of a group of British soldiers called the Chindits. And that was sort of a misinterpretation of the guardians of the temple in Burma. It was actually Chintha, but he heard it as Chindit. This is Phil Cochran. He was a 31-year-old colonel. He was charming, handsome, charismatic. He actually dated Betty White at one point. He was the real-life character of Flip Corkin in the comic strip Terry and the Pirates, which was one of the most popular strips of the day. And there it is. Okay. Johnny Allison was a little bitty guy. One of the guys called him, he was just a peanut, he said. He was a daring fighter pilot, however, who flew with in the last days of the AVG and then the 14th Air Force and 23rd Fighter Group. He was considered a natural pilot, a good stick, as they called him. One of the pilots in this group of 523 men was a guy named Jackie Coogan. Maybe you've heard of him if you watch the old silent movies late at night. Jackie Coogan was the biggest child star of his day, and later was Uncle Fester in the Addams Family. He was one of the he was a flight officer, and he was one of the pilots in the first Air Commandos. This handsome man on the right here is a guy named Dick Cole, and some of you may recognize who he's standing beside. That's a guy named Jimmy Doolittle. Okay. Dick Cole, who was one of the Tokyo Raiders, was also a First Air Commando. I just missed one again. I'm going to go back. As I said, they were a colorful bunch. Buddy Lewis was the all-star third baseman for the Washington Senators before the war. And he was also the an all-star ball player after the war, but he was a pilot in the First Air Commandos and a hump pilot. That's him on the left and him on the right as a baseball card. They also included a guy named Patt Meara. That's him in the center, the good-looking guy being chauffeured around. Did they call them rickshaws? Were they called a rickshaw in India as well? Okay. Well, there he is. Oh, he's here tonight. Charlie Turner, as I said, they were kids. Charlie Turner was a glider pilot. We were with him just last weekend down in Waco, Texas, 19 years old. He's wearing a hat, and you can see the patch there on his flight jacket. That hat was, they wore that in such a way that it looked kind of disheveled, and he called that his go-to-hell hat. Okay, that's what he called it. The operation involved a wide variety of flyers. Back in the day, there were pilots, there were service pilots, liaison pilots, glider pilots, all with different badges with letters in the insignia there. This particular group called the Air Commandos had about 100 Stinson L5 liaison planes. Small. This is the original plane that they wanted to use for this group to fly supplies into the Chindits behind enemy lines and to bring their wounded out. And I'll explain all of that in just a bit. They had 30 P-51A fighters. This is the one with the Allison engine, not the Merlin. They had 13, I was corrected, they had 13 C-47s that they used as glider tugs. A guy named Dick Cole flew one of those. They had about 100 Waco CG-4A gliders. Now, don't think of a soaring plane. Don't think of a modern glider. Think of a boxcar with wings, because that's what it was, and it flew just about like that, too. Yeah, they only had one flight profile. You know, you hear about thermals and, you know, all of that and ridge waves. Forget that. You release and they went down. Okay. The Waco gliders were boxcars with wings. Ne Punkawala were what those glider pilots were called by the locals. It meant no fan man. They didn't have any engines. The front of those flipped up with the cockpit, and you could drive a Jeep or an artillery piece or anything else into it. They carried up to about 15, perhaps, fully armed soldiers, or, as you can see, a lot of heavy equipment. They also had the world's first helicopters, four YR-4 helicopters that were the first operational and performed the first rescues of downed pilots. They had a dozen Stinson L1 flying ambulances. This is just for you guys who are really into aeroplanes. A dozen Nordyne Norsemen for use as a light cargo aircraft. As I said, there were 523 of this original group. About 300 of them were pilots. And for those of you who are in the service, you know what a disproportionate number that really represents. Okay. This guy, I don't think I can do that. No, I can't do it. The guy in the last row, the top row, far left, is a guy named Dick Cole. The guy in the exact center of the front row is Buddy Lewis. Dick Cole's good friend is Jake Sartz, is fourth from the left back row, and next to him, kind of bending over, is a guy named Wild Bill Cherry. And he's famous for a lot of things. One of them was flying Eddie Rickenbacker on that famed mission across the Pacific when they made a small navigation error and went down in the Pacific in a B-17 and floated on a life raft for 24 days. Yeah, he was also an Air Commando pilot. So this involved an operation known as Operation Thursday. It was launched from bases in India on March the 5th, 1944. When was D-Day again? June 6th of what year? This is a test. 44. So this precedes that by, I don't know, however many months that is. I'm not a math guy. 3 or 4 months. They sent this assault wave of gliders in months before the invasion in Europe. And in fact, Johnny Allison was called back to England to talk with Dwight Eisenhower about what they had learned in that glider assault that they could apply to what was going on in Normandy. Okay. I don't know if I skipped. When I was talking, was it when? Huh? Okay. Okay, this is Wingate. Well, 15 minutes before this scheduled launch, they discovered that, guess what? Somebody had dragged a whole lot of teak logs into this clearing in the jungle that they were going to take these gliders to. And so now what? Were the Japanese onto them? Had they found them? Would they be waiting for them? They didn't know. So Wingate on the right and Johnny Allison on the left, you know, they said, oh, what the heck, let's just go. We've done all this training. The guys are at the peak of it. You know, if they have to stand down, that won't be good. Let's just try it and see what happens. Hello. So these are the pilots at the briefing just before they launched into Broadway. As you can see, uniformity. These guys just gave the word uniform a bad name because they really didn't wear very much that resembled a uniform. They kind of dressed the way they wanted to, which was kind of an interesting thing. I've seen a photo of a group of, I don't know, about eight of them standing around all in the same section, and every one of them had a different hat on. From the bush hats, you know, to a crusher hat, to fore and aft, baseball caps, you name it. They were an interesting bunch. These were the British Chindits, and you can see that they're wearing the bush hats, and they're getting ready to board one of those gliders, along with some of the mules that they took along to carry their heavy equipment. They towed these gliders behind C-47s in something known as double tow, and we'll talk about that maybe in a little bit. That turned out to be a bad idea because they had to climb over an 8,000-foot ridge of mountains known as the Chin Hills. And, the gliders were just way too heavily overloaded, some by 2,000 pounds. We might let you know why that happened. But they broke, many of them broke, and they had interesting experiences getting back. Not only did they take off and tow these gliders, but so you take them and they land in a clearing in the jungle. Okay, now how are you going to get these gliders out? Well, you set them up. You set that long tow rope up on two, what were they, 12 feet high poles, and a C-47 with a special hook comes by and hooks it, and whew, if you're aboard the glider, you're going to get a ride. And if you're in the C-47 tug, you're going to go like that. if you catch one. It was explained to me that you knew you'd hooked one when it went like that, like somebody slamming on the brakes as you're going down the freeway. Okay. Virtually all of the gliders that went into Broadway that night were destroyed, because it turned out that what looked like a nice open clearing and a smooth field from a few thousand feet was full of ruts and logs and stumps hidden by very high grass. And they virtually all wrecked. A number of the commandos and Chindits were killed. But nonetheless, they were able to bulldoze out a clearing, a runway. And the very next night, C-47 started bringing in. At the end, they delivered about 10,000 British troops 150 miles behind Japanese lines, built a stronghold at Broadway, and essentially completed the first successful aerial invasion of a country in history. So that's the photos. Let me, if you don't mind, let me just kind of tell you how this happened. Okay, the Wingate, whom you saw, was unorthodox. He was brilliant, a little strange. Okay, but he, thank you. He decided early on that the best way to fight the Japanese was the best defense is a good offense. Okay, and so in 1943, he took a group of 3,000 British and Indian troops into Burma. They walked in carrying all of their equipment, and they had mules. And they stayed for a couple of months, and they discovered that it was a really bad thing if you got wounded or ill, because there was no way to get back. And so they left hundreds of these men propped up against trees with a rifle, some ammunition, and a little bit of food, and along with a note that said, "These are honorable soldiers. Please treat them accordingly." But they knew that if you were captured by the Japanese, it was not going to be good. And so when this group finally, you know, exhausted and worn out, came back to India, only 650 of those 3,000 men were fit for duty, okay? And they lost 900 of them, about 450 killed and about that many who had to be left behind. So although they were able to harass the Japanese, cut their lines of communication, blow up railroads, blast bridges, they in one way were successful, in another way, they just paid too heavy a price. And so, but still he was honored for all that had done, because there wasn't a lot of good things going on in the China-Burma-India theater at the time. And, you know, he made a lot of good ink. And so he was given a promotion, he was given another distinguished service order. And then he began to plan, okay, maybe what we need is a way to get these guys out if they get shot or get ill. What we need are some light planes like those L-5s that you saw. And so he happened to catch the eye of Churchill. Churchill called him back to England and said, "I'm going across the pond to meet with FDR, and I want you to go with me, because we don't have anything like that, and the Americans do." Okay, so they met in Quebec in August of 1943. FDR liked Wingate's plan. Very audacious, very, very bold, very innovative. And he said, "Yeah, we can help you. We have a lot of flying hardware, and we can make this happen." And so he turned that over to Hap Arnold, who was the commanding general of all the Army Air Forces. Hap Arnold tapped two of his, he asked around and said, who could lead a really strange and unorthodox and group, a highly secret project in Burma? And he asked around, and several names were thrown his way, and he called in Johnny Allison and Phil Cochran and said, "Guess what?" And these were already highly decorated fighter pilots who'd been fighting in North Africa. They had been flying. Johnny Allison had been in China. He was an ace with 7 victories. You know, they had things like the Silver Star and the Distinguished Service Cross. They were highly decorated and highly motivated. He called them in and said, "Guess what? You're going to lead a secret project." "Okay, good. What are we going to do?" "Well, I'm going to give you L-5 airplanes, and you're going to fly supplies into British troops." They didn't like that at all. And they said, no, we're not doing it. And he said, Colonels, I want you to count the number of stars on my shoulder, and then we'll talk about it later. Okay, so they both said, yes, sir, how many, sir? And they decided that maybe a really good idea if they did that. And then they set about creating this monstrosity, this extravaganza, and they said, you know, all we have to do is to make this so bold and so strange and so overreaching that Hap Arnold is going to kick us back out of here so that we can get into the big fight in Europe. And so they said, you know, what if we took Wingate's troops in by glider? Great idea. Okay, what if we had fighters to support them? Whoa, okay, that's good. Well, we're going to need cargo planes to pull the gliders, obviously, and what if we had some bombers, too? That'd be good. Then we could support these troops in all kinds of ways. We could be their artillery. They just went crazy. Anything that they asked for, Hap Arnold said, yeah, I like it, do it. Darn, they said. Okay, so we'll try this. You've got some new helicopters trying out there at Wright Field. How about if we got those? He said, okay. So they got the first four operational helicopters. Darn, that didn't work either. Well, then they began kind of having fun with it. And they invented this thing that later really gets, it's inter-allied. It has almost no bounds. It's autonomous. It answers only to Hap Arnold. Okay, and it has a single job to do, and that is to invade Burma and then get back out before the monsoons come. So you have to organize this, you have to find the men, you have to get the equipment, and you've got a total of 6 months to do it, to invent this entire thing. Piece of cake, right? Okay. Well, they set about to do that, and along the way they said, you know, we're wearing these flight jackets, you know, these A2 flight jackets. It's got two little bitty flap pockets in it. We can't carry very much in that. I think we'd like to have airborne uniforms with all those pockets, you know, like a bush jacket, and they got big old pockets on the sides of the legs. And the airborne said, no way. And Hap Arnold said, way. Okay, so they got airborne uniforms. They got to wear those. And then they discovered that they had just come out with the M1A1 folding stock carbine that was going to be issued to paratroopers. And they said, we want those. And they said, no. And Hap Arnold said, yeah. So they got them, and every man was issued a 45. Then they said, you know, we're going to be in kind of a jungle place over there. Burma is the world's worst terrain to ever pick to fight a war in, full of jungle, nasty beasts therein, 24-foot pythons, among other things, something like 40 species of poisonous snakes. During the monsoons, which are about 6 months of the year, you can't even walk. It just turns to sort of treacle mud. They said, you know, leather boots aren't going to do that. What if we got some of those great canvas and rubber boots the Marines have? And the Marines screamed, said, you're not getting our boots. They got the boots. Okay. So anyway, they got anything they wanted. And when they got to India, they began practicing with the British. And everyone's going, like, what are we going to do with these things? Okay, we got these gliders out there. What are you going to do with this? Well, we're going to tow you into clearings behind the lines. I don't think so. Yeah. Oh, did we mention we're going to do it at night? And then we're gonna send C-47s over, and we're going to snatch those gliders out of there at night. And they did. I may have mentioned to you that Wingate was a trifle strange. Elihu Epstein would eventually become the Israeli ambassador to the U.S., and then to the Court of St. James. And in 1937 in Palestine, he was a pretty noted scholar, and he heard that a recently posted army captain, who was a named Ord Wingate, who spoke Arabic and was a graduate of the School of Oriental and African Studies in London, had just been assigned to Palestine and had been invited to his house for a discussion of Persian literature. So he went there, knocked on the door, waited for the door to open, fingered his knot, get it straightened out, and he heard the noises inside. It was a hot day. Epstein knocked on the door of the Wingate residence and stood waiting on the doorstep as insects swarmed around a small date tree whose sweet aroma drifted over him. He heard stirring within the small house, and he self-consciously fingered the knot, pardon me, of his tie as the door bolt was released inside. The door swung open, and there stood a short, slight, dark-haired Englishman with a welcoming smile and intense dark eyes. It was Ord Wingate. He was stark naked. He invited Epstein in for the next 2 hours. They had a nice conversation about Persian literature. And then when that was over, Ord Wingate saw him to the door, still wearing just a smile. Yeah. I told you he was a little bit different. Okay. So they get Allison and Cochrane begin planning this thing. And Allison, I'm sorry, this is Cochrane, said later, we had to plan on supplying ourselves. We were to be superimposed on as a task force on an already beleaguered region, being China, Burma, and India. They didn't have any supplies. They were destitute out there. The big effort was going on in Africa and Europe, and they were not getting all the things they needed. So we had to plan to take much of our own supplies. We even took, for instance, our own cigarettes and our own powdered milk. There just wasn't any animal like this in the Air Force zoo. We were inventing a new one. There simply was no precedent. I may have mentioned to you about Buddy Lewis. Okay, and again, these were young kids. Remember that? Okay, so when they began recruiting these guys, they just got on the phone and called people that they knew and said, hey, how would you like to get out of your nice, comfortable bunk and your stateside duty, how would you like it if you joined the secret project that'll have absolutely no reward for you at all? It's highly dangerous. You will be in combat. What do you think? Well, yeah, sign me up. And so they did. Well, Buddy Lewis was one of those. Bill Cherry, Dick Cole, Jake Sartz were joined in Project 9 by additional pilots from the Transport Command, including Buddy Lewis. John K. Lewis, Jr. was best known as the third baseman for the Washington Senators. When the war started, he had gone through basic training as an infantryman and then was accepted for flight training. When posted overseas to the CBI to fly the hump, he had buzzed Griffiths Field during a game to say goodbye to his teammates. Luckily, no one thought to get the tail number of the plane that zoomed low over center field before disappearing to the south. In India, he named his transport the Old Fox for Clark Griffin, the senator's owner. Lewis went on to fly more than 350 missions over the Himalayas into China. I did talk to you about the glider snatches, which were done at night. I think maybe a little bit later I'll ask one of those guys that we're going to have you meet here in a little while how that went. Okay, how'd you like that, guys? They did haul these mules in to transport the heavy equipment of the Chindits around through the jungles over there. Wingate had never given up his fondness for using mules to haul equipment through the jungles, and part of the requirement for measuring the success of the operation would be delivering mules as well as men to the glider landing fields. That requirement sent Cochrane's men scurrying to devise a means of carrying the animals without fear that they would panic and kick the glider apart from inside. They consulted some British muleteers who sagely suggested construction of stalls inside the gliders to accommodate these animals. The muleteers even offered up some plans, and Cochrane's men dutifully constructed a set that could be installed in a glider with reinforced flooring. The weight, however, was excessive, and the glider men began thinking of other solutions. How about drugging the mules, something that would keep them sedated for a couple of hours? Well, the obvious downside was how to get them out quickly, especially under fire if they're staggering under sedation. So they loaded a couple of. Then somebody said, "You know, what? What are we doing this for? Why don't we just put them aboard one and see what happens?" So they did. Okay, they loaded a couple of mules aboard a glider, secured them with ropes and slings so they couldn't move about and disrupt the balance of the aircraft, and they told an attending trooper to shoot them if they began to panic. During the takeoff and flight, the mules were calm. They quietly chewed their feed, and they even leaned as the glider banked and climbed and descended. Well, that solved that problem. But another one was that the control cables were exposed in the glider, and they were afraid that their ears would get tangled in those controls, in those wires, and so they took strips of paper and tied their ears together so that they couldn't get into the way of the... Okay. At one point, Lord Mountbatten visits this far, this primitive airfield that they're stationed at. They had two about 12 miles apart, Halakandi and Lalagat in far eastern, northeastern India, a state called Assam. And Lord Mountbatten was the supreme commander of the Southeast Asian Command. And he showed up one day at the field just to visit them. He was kind of an admirer of these young Americans who could just do anything with such, you know, insouciance and just absolute cockiness. Oh, you want us to pick up gliders at night? Yeah, we can do that. It's never been done before, but shouldn't be a problem. Anyway, he came out to the field one day, and he was met by Cochrane, and he said, they asked him to make a little address to the troops, and he said, well, okay, I suppose I should. He tried not to frown as he said it. We'd be honored, of course, sir, Cochrane said, and Allison began looking around for suitable dyes. And the aide stepped up once more. He said, perhaps the hood of one of the jeeps would allow the assembled men to be able to see the admiral. Cochrane ordered all aircraft to stop flying and to shut down their engines to enable the supreme commander to be heard. Mountbatten stepped up to the front bumper of the jeep and then onto the flat hood of the little utility vehicle. He held his hands awkwardly in front of him and began an impromptu address to the American and British personnel. Cochrane was dressed in his usual khakis, rolled up past his ankles, his tan crusher hat well back on his head, an airborne jacket, and he looked up intently and watched. Next to him stood bareheaded Johnny Allison, likewise wearing the airborne uniform and sporting a Colt 22 pistol in a shoulder holster. He could shoot that one. A faint buzz caught their attention, and the American colonels looked at each other as it grew louder, distracting the audience from the inspirational words of their supreme commander. They both saw it at once, a P-51. They had forgotten that before Mountbatten arrived, R.T. Smith had taken off in his fighter, a P-51A christened Barbie. Tadpole Smith was a consummate fighter pilot, which meant, that, of course, that he was impetuous and high-spirited. Smith had been, he's 25 years old, he's a major, and had shot down eight Japanese aircraft when he was with the Flying Tigers. Smith, peering down from his cockpit at the crowd of soldiers and seeing a uniformed figure on the hood of a jeep, deduced that Cochrane was addressing the group. He couldn't resist. He pulled up, winged over, and came in low and fast, heading straight for the jeep at something more than 400 miles an hour. He pulled up at what must have seemed only inches over the head of Mountbatten, the blast from his propeller causing the theater commander to grab for his cap. Cochrane, who was never a stickler for military protocol, was appalled at this egregious breach of protocol, not to mention basic safety and common sense. So he quickly says to Mountbatten, that damn fool just arrived, Lord Louis. He was away and didn't know you were here. What kind of a court-martial would he have faced if one of his pilots had decapitated the commander of the Southeast Asian Command? Mountbatten was gracious but clearly angry with his aide for placing him in such a position. That's all right, the admiral said. I shouldn't be talking on a flying field. When Smith landed, Cochrane ordered him to the Operation Basha and laid into him, fiercely berating him for nearly beheading the SEAC commander. Cochrane's Irish temper was in high gear, and he had an enviable vocabulary of pejoratives and expletives that seemed to breed descriptions of ineptitude never previously heard in the English language. At last, he began to taper off, and Smith was finally able to offer an explanation of sorts. I'm sorry, Phil, but I didn't know it was Mountbatten. Honest, I thought it was you. With that, Cochrane launched into a second wave. But remember what I told you. These were kids. These were kids. He was 25 years old and a major. The Officers Club, just as an illustration of this, the Officers Club at an airfield in San Juan, Puerto Rico, displayed a sign over the bar that summed up the new reality. It said, no liquor will be served to lieutenant colonels between the ages of 18 and 21 unless you're accompanied by a parent. Okay. Okay. Jackie Coogan was one of these glider pilots, and maybe you can ask these guys about Jackie Coogan. I'm not going to repeat some of the stories, and if they have the guts, maybe they will. I don't know. Coogan was one of the glider pilots who was kind of out there. They all were, but. At Lagat, construction continued while gliders and tugs made continuous takeoffs and landings. As the gliders landed, the pilots waited until a truck was available to pull this powerless aircraft back to the runway takeoff position, or if it was the final flight of the day, a revetment. The wait could be several minutes or much, much longer on a busy day. Coogan landed his glider one day and waited impatiently for the truck to appear. It was hot, well over 100 degrees. Coogan, who could be impetuous, spotted an elephant nearby that was being used as a heavy construction vehicle. That's what they used. They had these elephants that acted as a crane, just heavy, you know, you get the picture. Okay. So instead of waiting for the truck, Coogan reasoned that the pachyderm could pull his heavy glider to the staging area. What could go wrong? Coogan convinced the mahout, the elephant handler, to bring his mount over to the glider, and in short order, they had tied a tow rope from the nose of the Waco to a harness rigged around the elephant. Coogan entered the cockpit to be able to brake and control the glider during the tow, and at first, it worked like a charm. Coogan would be first done for the day, and a new page in glider towing would be written for posterity. Alas, the elephant had been trained to lift and to push, but had never been used to pull anything. So it was nervous, for something was following it, and it increased its gait. The pachyderm's eyes were wide and fearful as it looked behind. Something large and menacing was following it close behind, so it went faster yet. Soon the panic-stricken elephant was trumpeting his terror and galloping toward a line of trees at the end of the field, impervious to the commands of the mahout, and who is now holding on for dear life. Coogan watched in horror as the trees grew closer and the elephant's speed grew faster. Braking was no help at all. It ended badly. The elephant, seeking the protection of the forest, charged between two large trees, breaking the tow line, but also shearing off both wings. The glider was a total write-off. Cochran was pretty unhappy with Coogan, but he didn't take any action against him. He needed these guys. So. That's just a little bit of what's in the book and a little bit of the story of the Air Commandos. But I think right now we just need to talk to some guys who were there. You know, all I did was write this book. These guys lived it. Okay. So perhaps, okay, Pat Murray, Dick Cole, Bill Cartwright, if you'd join me up here, okay, why don't you come on up right now? I think maybe we'll start this conversation by, I want to ask the two that are up here right now, we'll be joined by a third one here in just a minute. How did you get hooked into joining the Air Commandos? It was a pretty unorthodox outfit. And you were promised absolutely nothing except some grave danger and some adventure. Why did you guys get in the Air Commandos? Dick, you want to talk to me? Why did you go in the
Air Commandos? How
did you get in the Commandos?
How did you get in the Commandos?
I had been flying over in that area into Kunming during or after the raid, and consequently I got to know John Allison and when he was flying for the Flying Tigers. When we went home or came home, got a call from him wanting to know if I would go back over with the 1st Air Commandos. Well, I had a phone conversation with a guy by the name of Jake Sartz that had been my roommate during the time we were flying the hump. And we talked on the phone and both decided, we'd like to go back. So that's how it happened.
probably should point out that flying the hump at that point in those early days of flying the hump, which was 1942 to 1943, they were flying C-47s that didn't have a service ceiling that was as high as the peaks of the Himalayas. The weather was the worst in the world. There were no weather reporting stations, no navigation aids, and except for that, you know, it was a pretty easy run. They did, in the end, I think, lose something like 600 aircraft and crews. At one time, it was more dangerous to fly the hump than it was to fly a round trip to Berlin and back. How'd you get in the Commandos?
It was easy. I had been in North Africa. Oh, been in North Africa for 4 months and was shipped to Calcutta, India, and up to a place which is now the center of Pakistan. We didn't know it then, but it was Dhaka. And there were four of us who were noted for being characters, and we didn't necessarily agree with that. But they came in and wanted four volunteers. As Denny says, they didn't tell us what it was for, just that it would be hazardous duty and we would get combat pay. And all four of us stood up, and the next day they put us in the little light planes like Bill used to fly, the L-1s, with a barracks bag and a gun across our lap, and flew us up to the upper Assam Valley. And I walked in and was greeted. I made the remark yesterday that Colonel Cochran knew the name of every man in the outfit, and every man's name was Sport. And
it was Sport if he liked you. He had other terms if he didn't.
Well, fortunately, yeah. I never got one of those.
Yeah. Well, you're such a good guy.
But when I landed, he was over by the operations thing, and he slapped me on the back and said, "Welcome, Sport."
Yeah.
And that's how I became a commando.
Okay, thank you, Pat. Bill, talk to us a little bit about flying an L-5 and what's that like.
Well, this was a two-place airplane tandem, one behind the other. Used for had various jobs in the States flying them and other layers on aircraft. So I got into the 1st Air Commando very late in the day, but I was training down in Texas on that, and we had pilots that had been overseas come back and helped in this training. And that was very useful. So I was just sent over as a replacement. You didn't know where you were going or what you were going to do when you got there or when you were going to come back. We enlisted for the duration plus 6 months, and that was it. A man was going over on the flight with us that had been over there for about 3 years. He'd gone back on emergency leave, lost a family member, something like that, and he was still going back. So it looked like it's going to last forever. So you know, I got in that way and then found out what the 1st Air Commando was up to after I got to India. We didn't even know it was going to the country of India when I left the States. That's the way it was then.
I am just a little bit curious. You all can help me. How many of you already knew a great deal about the 1st Air Commandos in World War II? I see one hand.
Two?
You don't count. Your daddy was there. Okay. There's probably a really good reason why most of you have not heard about the invasion of Burma by glider and all the other things that the commandos did. One, it was top secret. Two, it was unfortunate in its timing so far as any kind of publicity is concerned, because Life magazine did a really nice story and series of photos about these guys for their June 12th issue, and it came out on June the 6th, and they printed about 1,000 copies of this magazine. When they got word of Operation Overlord and the invasion at Normandy, they stopped the presses, quite literally, pulled out all of the articles about the Air Commandos and put in everything that they could find about the invasion going on at Normandy. There was a third reason, too. There's not a lot available in the way of written reports and material on these guys, because Hap Arnold, as a sort of a sop to Allison and Cochran, said, okay, to hell with the paperwork, get out there and fight. And so they took him at his word. I mean, the very earliest days of this, when they lost several fighter pilots, for example, they didn't even file MACRS, the missing air crew reports. It was only after, I don't know, a couple of months of doing that. At one point near the end of this operation, they sent a guy in from the Joint Intelligence Collection Agency to help them out with this paperwork, and one of their official reports was this poor guy was in despair at what he found. It was just a mess. So trying to write about these guys has been somewhat of a challenge, but being able to speak to ones who were there has made it a real pleasure instead of an obstacle. Dick, if you don't mind, could you, and this will be my last question, then I'm going to let you guys ask, okay? You guys get to do interaction with the audience thing. Okay, that'll be fun. Dick, talk to us about what that was like to come down in a C-47 with that special equipment on and pick up, snatch a glider from a dead stop. Can you explain how that worked?
Well, the C-47 had a reel that was operated by the crew chief. That he had to go to a school someplace in Maryland where they installed him and learn how to do it. You approach the pickup line at about 100 miles an hour, and he lowers the special arm that they hydraulic that they installed on the C-47, which was about 16 feet long, I think. You approach the line to what you think you're going to hook, and a lot of times it's maybe a little bit hairy because you didn't pick it up on the first attempt. And it was particularly hazardous at night because you had a,
really?
A night kit that they used. It was two poles and a rope, but the poles were, I really don't remember, but they were maybe 12 feet apart. And to light them up, they had two flashlights, one on each pole, and we were able to do pickups that we didn't have any accidents, and so we figured it was a pretty good deal.
So the impossible takes a little longer, but the really difficult, no problem, no problem at all. You know, I think at this point, I think you all ought to find out what you want to know from these guys. They represent a pretty unique bunch of guys, and there's a lot to be learned from them, so I hope that you'll come on up and ask a question. Some of you, let me just, one caveat. Most of you probably know the guy in the middle, and you may want to ask some questions about another thing that he did over, I don't know, a city called Tokyo or something. And that's fine, but if you can hold those questions for later in the session, and let's concentrate on the Air Commandos at first, if that's okay. But you'll have to come up here and use the mic.
I'll take it out.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, my question is, you know, professionals talk logistics. You're at the end of a very long supply line in the Forgotten Army area under Slim. You had very few mechanics in your outfit. How did you keep the availability of aircraft up with in such terrible climate with such little logistics support?
Go ahead, answer that, Pat.
I don't know what he said.
Okay. Let me just quickly brief you on that, and then they can give it some detail. Every man picked for this had to have a secondary and a tertiary skill. Most of the pilots did all of the work themselves. So if you were a pilot, that was one mark that was good. If you were also a mechanic, we'll listen to what you have to say. And if you were a pilot and a mechanic and could play a piano, you're in. You want to add anything to that, anybody?
Oh, I had one thing. Liaison pilots named Jack Gallagher was also somewhat of a mechanic. And the planes we used, we just had seats for two passengers sitting upright like we are tonight. And, of course, some of the wounded were needed to be on stretchers. So he modified one of these L5s himself, and so that he could put a stretcher in the back and the rear of the airplane opened up so that he could get it in there. Now, this was under field conditions, and a man that was not trained to do that in the beginning. So besides Jack, we had a lot of very dedicated mechanics over there, and they just got it fixed. Pat and I were coming across country, and we stopped at a motel that had a wobbly table that wouldn't work very well with our computers. So I went out and got my crescent wrench and tightened it up so we could use it. That's just the way what GIs do.
If I may add one thing, I'm not sure of it, but I'd almost bet that it was in our outfit that the phrase GI ingenuity was born, because everybody there would be in a situation that normally wouldn't occur, and suddenly somebody figured out how to handle it. It just happened. It was probably the greatest bunch of guys I ever saw. Not probably, they were.
I should point out that they were also probably the most casual military outfit in the history of military. They didn't know how to salute. They just forgot that entirely. Enlisted men and officers, most of the officers didn't even wear insignia. They never saluted. They ate together. At one point, a general came in to visit and walked into the mess deck, and they were, I'm sorry, that's a float, that's a Navy kind of a term.
Mess hall.
The mess hall, and saw all these enlisted men eating with the officers, everybody calling each other by their first name, and said, he just blew up. And he said, what is going on? And Phil Cochran said, well, it's the only place we have to eat, sir. If you would rather, we can sit you a table outside. He did rather, and they did. I mentioned to you about their informality with uniforms, and they were that way. Cochran and Allison both believe that, you know, let's kind of leave this the spit and polish out of it, and let's just see if they can do their job. Let's let them go. Okay. At one point, I'm going to try to find it in here. I'll read you something in just a little bit. Who else has a question?
Thank you so much for being here. It's so thrilling to listen to you. My question has to do with, you know, you were over there in the worst of circumstances. There was no way to get letters from home or to send letters, I assume.
Yes. But
what did you do to sustain yourself at those moments when you must have at some point felt some sort of despair or discouragement? I mean, I know you had a purpose and you had teamwork, but what were your quiet moments when you wondered, am I ever going to get out of this?
Oh boy, I don't ever recall experiencing one of those. It was such an adventure, and we were doing so much that I never had time to think about it. I don't know about these other guys.
No, we just thought about doing the job, and I don't remember ever having that sort of a thought, ma'am.
It was a job and a camaraderie like I have never seen in any place else in life.
Okay, I'm going to brag on these guys. This gentleman to my right is 92. And the gentleman on the far end is 91.
I'm sorry.
Okay. And he, both of these gentlemen, Pat and Bill, one lives in Florida, one lives in Georgia. And just before this program, just a couple of days ago, got a phone call that said, you know what, I think maybe we'll just make this a road trip. And so they drove from Florida and Georgia. And you know, my wife asked him, I said, really? And I said, yeah, but if you'll think about this, they were the ones who were kids all those years ago who said, dangerous job, combat pay, no reward, sign us up. And so this thing about road trip shouldn't have been a surprise.
Yeah, Dennis, my 54-year-old daughter is taking the place of my mother now, giving me
That happens at a certain age.
She says her old dad can't drive these long trips anymore. I've been going between Colorado and Florida for many years. And so I'm the one that's 92, so I got a 91-year-old helper, and we made the trip without any problem.
What could go wrong?
In my time frame, I've learned enough. I'm not going there.
His time frame, incidentally, is he's 98. He'll be 99 in September. And I should also point out, I'm going to brag on him just a little bit. There were 16 million Americans who served in uniform in World War II. There's one of those 16 million who was a Doolittle Raider, a hump pilot, and an air commando, and he's here tonight. That worked then, when we electrified these chairs, we were hoping that would work, that you'd have to stand up. That was good. That was good. As I said, they were a fairly unconventional bunch, and Wingate, when he went on campaign, always grew a beard, and they liked that. They thought that was pretty cool. So all the commandos, or many of them, began growing beards, and you know, they let their hair grow. They didn't wear shirts. They didn't wear insignia. And one day, the commanding general of the area showed up, and he saw that and ripped the nearest officer a strip, okay? So Phil Cochran wrote the following memo to the Air Commandos. He said, to all personnel and attached organizations, look, sports, the beards and attempts at beards are not appreciated by visitors. Since we can't explain to all strangers that the fuzz is a gag or something I always wanted to do affair, we must avoid their reporting that we are unshaven, regulations say you must shave, by appearing like Saturday night in Jersey whenever possible. Work comes before shaving. You will never be criticized for being unkempt if you're so damn busy you can't take time to doll up. But be clean while you can. Ain't it awful? And he signed it P.G. Cochran, Colonel Air Corps Commanding. That may be one of the funniest memos ever written to an organization by its commanding officer.
That memo was posted on the door at Air Force Supply, which was a shack, a basha, for all the guys to see, and was listed as a special order.
There you have it. There you have it. Who else has a question?
I just wondered, how many of these guys stayed in the Air Force after World War II?
I did.
Bill did, yeah.
Well, not exactly stayed in. I got out at the end of the war, and it looked like the world was going to be in a mess for a while, and I didn't want to be called back in as a private. So I was a tech sergeant then, so I signed up in reserve. In 1950, Mr. Truman sent me a telegram to come back to work for him. So after already had in 4 years, so I stayed in and finished up my 20. And the last 14, I was working on nuclear weapons.
Okay. And anybody in the middle? Did anybody in the middle of this trio stay in the service? Dick? He did. He stayed in, Lieutenant Colonel. Other questions? Okay.
I didn't hear the question.
I have one.
Dick, did you stay in the service? He did.
You started out as a part of the Army and then became the Air Force, and now they're trying to get the Air Force and the Army to work together again and are having difficulties with that. What suggestions would you have on that?
It was a lot of fun being in the Air Corps.
Yeah.
They've even changed the words of the Air Corps song to fit the Air Force, and it upsets me every time I hear it. I still get hackles every time I hear it, though.
Bill or Dick, do you have any suggestions on how to make the Army work better with the Air Force?
I wish I did. It has always been...
I think whatever I would say would be a little bit too much lean toward the Air Force.
Well, we were in the Army Air Corps during World War II, but we considered us ourselves far superior to the ordinary Army people, although we weren't.
that does not bode well for cooperation.
Yeah, all the three services have that sort of attitude toward each other, so it's hard to change that.
Question.
This is a question for Mr. Cartwright. When you were flying your L-5, what was the state of the enemy air power at the time, and did you ever run into any enemies?
I didn't.
Enemies?
I got over the India very late in the campaign, and I really didn't get into any anything like that. But I can answer some questions from people I've talked to, but I don't remember anything particular about that.
I can say that the Japanese Air Force kind of ruled the sky when they first got there, but in a single day, they destroyed something like 40 aircraft in a single day, the Air Commandos did, by attacking their airfields. They said that that was the largest loss of Japanese airplanes at the time. They accounted for 20% in a single day of the Japanese Air Force. The Air Commandos never lost a cargo plane to Japanese fighters, and they never lost an L-5 to Japanese planes. At one time, one of the Air Commando fighter pilots, Paul Forsey, said, "You know what? If I were flying an L-5 instead of a P-51, I think I could avoid being shot down by anybody." And Bob Pettit, another one of the really good fighter pilots, said, "I don't think so. I can shoot you down in an L-5. So they took the bullets out, and they mounted gun cameras in there, and Paul Forsey went up in an L-5, and every time he came after him, he turned inside. And the gun camera clearly showed that Paul Forsey was never hit. That made the L-5 pilots feel a lot better. They thought, you know, maybe Mama is not going to have to cash that life insurance policy in after all. Who else has a question? We've answered everything you ever wanted to know. There's one, and there's one over here, too.
Were you ever able to tell your families what you were doing while you were in India or any of that thing, or was it that classified?
Now we could write back home, but we couldn't tell them about anything about what we were doing. No, no.
It's like, "Dear Mom, camp is fine. The food is wonderful, and the guys are great, and the counselors are really good." That was the kind of letter they could send home. Yeah.
Before I went up to the Upper Assam Valley, I was at a base in Dhaka, India, which is now part of Pakistan. But I tried, in those days, the Andrews sisters were singing on Decca Records. And I wrote to my mother and went through a big, elaborate thing about how I loved to listen to the Andrews sisters and their music, and that we didn't have any of their records over there. And she might go out and buy me one and send it to me. And if she substituted A for the second letter in the name of the record, she would know where I was. And they cut the whole darn thing out of the letter.
Too clever by half, right? There was a question over here that I saw. Yeah.
I'm just curious. Our country during World War II really rallied around the cause, from factories to people buying war bonds to... getting behind the severity of the situation. And I think most troops at least my perception, that you came back to America and America celebrated what you did, and there was a feeling of satisfaction, gratification from the general public. I'd like to know, over now the last 70 years, if you feel that has changed, that tone has changed in our country, and if our population appreciates what the military is doing today, which is I'm not debating whether it's a good or a bad cause, but we are at war in doing things to help make the world a better place today. I'm curious your thoughts about if our country appreciates that, maybe like they did back in World War II, and if there's a concern from any of you about how our country views the military and what our role is in the world today, if that makes sense.
Well, it's changed dramatically in World War II. Everybody in the country, man, woman, child, whatever, was of the same thought as far as winning the war. Do everything you have to. And starting with Vietnam, the country as a whole does not support the troops. And some of the people who came back from Vietnam were ashamed to tell them they were over there. And that's terrible. I was in the service during that time, of course, but not in Vietnam.
Pat, were you going to say something, Pat?
I was going to say very much the same thing. We were the entire country was a homogeneous mass with one main goal. And they did it, the sacrifices that they made. When my folks wrote to me and told me about being on ration and what they were actually getting, and then I realized that when we got two bottles of beer a month and we could buy cigarettes for a nickel a pack over in India, it kind of made the sacrifices hit home, I guess, but there is none of that that I know or see in the effort today. The guys are over there fighting, and the people are behind them, but there's no really push to get the job done, period.
Can I get you to recall a comic strip called Pogo?
Yeah.
I think that saying is true, that I have met the enemy and the enemy is us. We spend a lot of money trying to help people overseas, other countries, and first off, it's not appreciated, and every dollar we spend, we become more like them. And I think there should be a real, real good look at where the money's going and make some changes.
You know, if you think about it, World War II was a war that united us, and I think every war since has divided us.
Yeah.
Do we have any other questions? Sure. Looks like there's one more in the back row.
Could you give your ranks when you're overseas, starting with the gentleman in the orange?
What was your rank? Sergeant.
My highest rank was staff sergeant, but I got busted.
he got caught.
I'll go you one better than that. I got court-martialed because I hit a British colonel.
He shouldn't have been where he was swinging his fist.
No, he got in the way of my fist.
Yeah. Dick?
Dick, what was your rank over there? Your rank in India?
I was a captain.
Okay.
And I went over a staff sergeant and came back a technical sergeant.
Okay. One more?
Okay, I guess this may be the last question, want to thank you. But the British experience on this, the Chendits, when they were at the end of the supply line, there's someone who wrote very movingly about this, John Masters, in The Road Past Mandalay. He was in the Broadway and then the Blackpool pocket. He thought that the use of these highly trained British troops was a waste. Did you get that feeling when you were taking the troops into Burma, that and when they came out of Burma, what was your feeling of the troops and how they felt?
Well, I didn't understand that.
What did you think, how do you feel that the British troops felt about being at the end of the supply line and whether they, I guess it has to do with the morale of the British troops. Do you think the morale of the Chindits was pretty high, or do you think they felt like they were misused and abused?
Well, at the reunions we've had over here, some of the British have retired over here to the States or to Canada, and they have come to some of our reunions after all these years. There were some at the 50th First Air Commando reunion, and I think they must think fairly highly of us, so they wouldn't take the time to come down from Canada to Florida to our reunion.
I would point out that when Wingate formed this, he did not want some highly specialized troops. He wanted to use ordinary Tommies because he thought that's what they needed. And at one point, I mean, he just whipped them into shape is what he did. At one point, one regiment coming in from England had like a 70% illness rate. And he said, we're not going to do that anymore. So he issued a command that no officers could be ill and that any men who were ill had to be personally examined by the commanding officer. And, you know, the illness report for that unit went from 70% to 2% very quickly. He also insisted that they run everywhere that they went. So after a while, they began to think, you know what? We're pretty damn good. Yeah.
Dennis, we have one more question up here, and I know we have some questions about the Doolittle raid.
Okay.
I know he's been waiting a while here.
As a recently retired Army guy and always looking at leadership, what might be, and our daughter just entered the Air Force as an officer, what might you say to our current generation on leadership? What might be a top leadership quality from your experience or your that needs to be taught or practiced today by our next generation?
Cool boy. I didn't hear the question. Anything about leadership that you would give advice to someone just going into service?
Well, I guess there's been enough books written by people that had ideas about leadership. The first thing I would recommend that they use their computer and get a collection of leadership pointers so they can dig them out.
Anyone else? What would you look for in a leader? Hmm? What would you look for in an officer? What were the officers that made you respect and want to follow their commands?
Probably the fact that, one, you brought it up, we did not observe the non-familiarization thing. Johnny and we called them Johnny and Phil. It wasn't Colonel Cochran and all that. And all of us, as I said, were sport. But he'd slap you on the back and say, hey, sport, I want you to do so-and-so, and you did it. But the man knew both of them knew they were going, what the plan was, and they took us there. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that's happening in our armed forces today. Mm-hmm. It's guy makes a field lieutenancy, and the next day they kill him. So I don't know. It's our armed forces to me today, I wouldn't want to be a part of.
In late March of 1944, a captain, Leon Durr Jr. of the Joint Intelligence Collecting Agency, spent some time with the Air Commandos, and in one of his reports, this is what he says about what you just asked. He said, the status of discipline in the Air Commando force is said to have confounded more than one high-ranking visitor, confused by the fact that enlisted men and officers of all ranks share and share alike, and the further fact that no point was ever raised about personal appearance. About morale, however, there can be no doubt. If Phil or John says do it, then by God we do it, is a common expression that ends all question. The existence of a commander and deputy commander in such perfect accord that the decision of one is automatically the decision of the other is not the least remarkable aspect of the Air Force.
Bill, do you recall ever having received an order while you were in the commandos?
Received an order, no. What I was thinking about...
A lot of suggestions.
We were asked to do something and given suggestions, but I never, as far as I can recall, never received an order from an officer or a non-com while I was in the service.
I could cite an example from civilian life. I worked for a man in Colorado for about 10 years. I respected very much. But during that 10 years, he never told me to do anything. He would say, Bill, can we do this? He knew I would do it, but by treating me that way, he got the best effort I could give him. I think that would work in the military just as well.
Probably a key factor was the fact that we were instilled with a desire to do the job.
That may run counter to a lot of manuals. I don't know.
Yes, it would. Yeah. It would.
Okay.
But it works.
We may want to go ahead and allow some questions then about the raid, if you have some.
I have a question for Captain Cole. Could you tell us about your personal experience after the raid and where you landed and what happened to you after the raid on Tokyo?
What happened to you after the raid on Tokyo?
Yeah.
We're all a little deaf up here.
He grew old.
Yeah.
He was talking in my good ear.
Hey, Dick, why don't you talk to them about after you dropped those bombs on Tokyo and headed for China, then what happened?
You got two things going here at once. After the raid, and we all ended up in China and reached safety through the good help of the Chinese. We were taken to the provisional capital of China at the time, and briefed and so forth. And since we'd lost all our clothes, we were then sent to Calcutta, where we were outfitted in the British uniforms because they did not have a supply of American uniforms over in Calcutta yet. I went back to the northeastern part of China, or India, and they had a couple of B-25s and a few more pilots and air crews that they needed. And the 10th Air Force was trying to run a war from New Delhi, India, which didn't work. We are kind of hanging loose for a month or so, and they put out the word that they were looking for pilots to learn to fly the C-47 and make up the air link between India and China to keep China in the link of the Allies, because the Japanese had cut the Burma Road, which was the only outside connection that China had at that time. She was otherwise isolated. So there were six of us, that decided to go on the transport route. And we got checked out in C-47 and started flying the hump. We did that in the C-47 till the December 5th, December of 43, when they started sending converted B-24s called C-87s, which was nothing more than a cargo plane. And we were particularly happy about that because it had turbos on the engines and you could climb to 30,000 feet and go over most of the high terrain. And we did that for 14 months and finally they gave us a medal and said, go home.
So he did. And then he went back. Other questions for Dick? Here's one.
On the Ray, when you figured out what you were doing or told what you were doing, what were your thoughts on the Ray?
What did you think about the fact that you had to go over and bomb Tokyo?
Off a carrier.
Well, it was my job. actually, it was the only job I ever had that had any future to it. I did a lot of things trying to get money to go to college. And, I said the oath and signed my name, so that was it.
That was the attitude of most people in World War II, contrary to what it is now.
Do we have another question? There's one.
I've been asked that many times, but I think he was all the good things that you can think of rolled up into one. He was a gentleman. He was a very, very well-educated man. He was a educated or education-oriented. You may or may not know that he received the first doctor's degree in aircraft aeronautical engineering from MIT. He was a very good pilot. In fact, I think he was the greatest pilot of the propeller-driven time. But on top of that, his personality, he was very friendly. He called everybody by their first name. He was open to any question, and he wasn't pompous. Even though he was the aircraft commander, he considered himself as one of the team members. I think that's where the impetus to the team approach to tasks came from.
Is that it? Is that the last question? It looks like we may have one more. Okay. We'll make that the last question.
To you, what if somebody
stands out in your mind as one of the things that you think, wow, I can't believe we did that? You know, one of your moments, maybe from your service. Mm.
Was there a question hidden in there?
What to you was the most remarkable part of your service?
I couldn't hear it anyway, but
Bill, you want to shout in his good ear?
Oh, yeah. I want to know what was one remarkable part of your service. What was the most important one thing you did?
I figure joining up and doing my job was it.
Right. I'll throw in one little thing. It's not the first Air Commando, but they sent me over to the Philippines after that, and I flew the mail up and down through the Philippines, and we had several routes we took with the L5, and we had a detachment of 8 people up in Lingayen Gulf. I went going down toward Manila one day, and they said they had a lot of mail up for the very northern tip of the Philippines, Aperi. There's a bunch of guys up there. The war was over. They didn't have any job and anything to do but sit there and wait for the points to build up so they could go home. And they were always begging for an extra movie or something when we went through there. Anyway, this was an extra trip. They had a lot of Christmas mail, December 1945. And so we loaded the little L5 right up to the roof. The back seat was all we had. And I went up through the middle of the island, a trip that I had not made before, but there was nothing unusual about that. So I climbed up to a safe altitude. There was no air traffic in the area. So I turned the airplane loose, and it'll fly by themselves, and read my mail to my detachment of 8 people. I got a letter from my mother that my beloved grandfather had died. I cried for the first time as an adult, about 4,000 feet over the Philippines, the other side of the world from Tifton, Georgia. I went on over the tents, went down over the tents about 200 feet twice and a steep bank, hopefully so they could see all those mail bags in the back seat. So I went in and landed. Most of the troops were out at the trip to see those mail bags come off. So I had the saddest part of my career and the happiest part about an hour apart over in the Philippines. That's it.
Is there a story that you can tell in mixed company?
Not many. No, I would honestly have to say I was in the service from February of 42 until February of 46. Of that time, from February of 44 until September, I was in the Air Commandos. And that entire period of time had to be the major thing that, as far as the importance of my wartime effort, with one other exception, which is a long-winded story, and I'll make it short. How many people in this crowd knew of or knew the actor Melvin Douglas?
There's one. There's
okay,
two.
We've got one back there and one over here. Melvin Douglas, after the Japanese surrender, formed a group called Entertainment Production Unit. And rather than get involved in the air service group again, I volunteered for it and wound up my co-star in the thing, and we produced the Arsenic and Old Lace. And I played the part of Martha Brewster. My co-star was a Red Cross girl who played my sister Abby. But they set, had an Indian dressmaker make, the entire thing for me, all pads and what have you. And an Indian shoemaker made a lady's shoes big enough to fit me, shaved my head and my face down to the place where it was, well, to all intents and purposes, I was bald, period. And the show was done in several different locations in India. And one night, a British colonel brought his wife backstage to meet the crew. And I was standing back there taking off my costumes. And first of all, the security guard made a pass at me. And secondly, when I peeled off this top part with the pads, and the British major's wife saw the hair on my chest, she said, "Oh my God, he's a male."
I was a little worried about where this was going. We do have, these gentlemen have something that they would like to give to the library, a couple
yes,
of things.
Would. Mark?
Carl, are you still here? Or Tim? Okay, Tim? Okay. I'm going to let you guys do the honors here.
Two mementos of the two organizations. For your hospitality.
And, well, thank you. We're honored. We're honored. Thank you very
and
much.
And we are.
It's a print of the B-25 that Dick was co-pilot of in the raid on Tokyo, signed by three of the surviving four Doolittle Raiders, and a booklet that in sort of abbreviated form tells a short history of the Air Commandos, signed by these three gentlemen, and they'll be part of the library here. So that's it. You've heard the stories of these three gentlemen, and that's it for the program. If anybody would like to come up and chat with them, they're going to stay here for a little bit. And if you want something where you want something signed, you know, like a check or something, come on up and talk to them. Thank you very much for being here. We appreciate it.
Line up this way. By the wall, if you will. Line up by the wall.